we really thank you for what we are to one and another and what we can be to one and another. But we really need your presence to move hearts and minds. Without you we can do nothing. And we earnestly pray that you lift our attention levels and absorption capacity and our attention, that it may be that good that one day soon we will share with others, each and every one of us, about the wonderful truth that we can learn from the word, spoken word and the written word. Bless us now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
It says he had been the wrong way, go back. I got scared of that. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm glad to see you. And it's true what Baron says, that you know, this side is healthy, that side is very, you know, very thin. If we keep putting people on this side, the auditorium is going to go like that. It's going to turn over. I'd like this morning or this afternoon to invite you to open your Bible in the book of Luke to a well-known parable. Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18. And we'll take it from verse 10. Luke chapter 18, and we'll read from verse 10. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortionists, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. It's a very interesting parable, because it's a parable of contrasts. And it's a parable that you and I may not get the impact that it actually had in its days. Jesus, in this parable, wants to teach a very important lesson, which is the basis for our acceptance before God. And he uses two men that come to the temple to pray. One is a Pharisee, and the other, the tax collector. You see, these two men represent two extremes in the Jewish society of the days of Jesus. The tax collector, I mean the Pharisee is, what can we paint him today? It's in Advent circles, it's difficult to paint a figure like the Pharisee, because we do not have people like that in our church. But the Pharisee was the epitome of religion. He was the man that lived for his faith. He wanted to be faithful. He tried to keep the law. And as a matter of fact, he boasted the fact that he kept the law of Moses. He lived, even his clothes resembled what Moses said was to happen. The color of his clothes, the things that he had inside, everything resembled the law. He was a good man. In the eyes of society, if you and I were growing in that society, and you got married and you had little children, you would want your children to be a Pharisee. These people gave large offerings, they stood to pray when times to pray came. They prayed in public, they visited the widows, and They were religious. They knew. These people knew the Old Testament off the top of their heads. They were deeply religious. They were at church at every meeting. And they went to the temple at the exact hours of prayer, morning and evening. And the tax collector. Well, the tax collector is the opposite to the Pharisee. I don't know what can we use him to, what figure we can use in society today to illustrate the tax collector. The tax collector, it's a hated figure in Jewish society. They hate him because he's a traitor. He has sold himself to the Roman government. He works for the Romans to extract money from his, you know, fellow Jews. So he is absolutely hated. He has most probably made a fortune. And in Jewish society, there are two classes that were classified as sinners. When the Bible speaks of sinners, in the New Testament, they usually speaking about two classes, prostitutes and tax collectors. Tax collectors, they were at the bottom of the barrel. And they come to the temple to pray. And I imagine the audience, as they listen to the parable, the audience, they are sure that the tax collector, I mean the Pharisee is the one who is going to be patted on his back by God. It's a good boy. But notice the conclusion to the parable. This must have been a shocking statement in the ears of those who heard this parable. When Jesus says, I tell you this. I tell you, this man, referring to the tax collector, went down to his house justified. That is the only time that Jesus uses that theological word. Rather than the other. That must have been absolutely shocking, because what Jesus is saying is that the religious man, the man that lives for church, the man that does all the right things, the man that is good in his own eyes and in the eyes of society, he goes home thinking that he's accepted, but actually behind the scenes, he is not accepted. He's actually in a worse situation than the tax collector, because that the tax collector, even though he's rejected by everyone and treated as dirt, he is accepted by God. And so this parable is supposed to challenge and lead us to ask a question. And the question is this: how are we accepted before God? Because when you look at the scriptures, you'll find that Jesus often says, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go ahead of you to the kingdom. Jesus meets the rich young ruler, another man like the Pharisee, a perfect young man, a young man that I wish my children were like him. But at the end of the day, the rich young ruler is lost, being so good. So then, we must ask the question and answer it. How are we accepted before God? Do you reckon that is a fair question? Yeah? Well, today we are going to answer it in the two programs. The first program, we're going to answer how we are not accepted before God. And in the second part of the program, we're going to answer the question, how we are actually accepted before God. Come with me to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 3. We are going to spend a lot of time in Romans chapter 3 today. Romans chapter 3, the favorite chapter of the scriptures for me. Chapter 3 and chapter 4. Paul comes to a conclusion in verse 20 of chapter 3. And he says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. Paul there has told us the way we are not accepted by God. According to Paul and according to Jesus, if you come like the Pharisee, loaded before the, you know, the presence of God, and you come loaded with God, I do this, and look what I have, and you can present your best works before God, and you can show Him your best behavior and your best goodness. It says, Jesus and Paul say, that it is not enough for God to accept us. Because our acceptance in the presence of God, the condition of acceptance before God, is not based on our behavior. Let me say this way. When you look at the scriptures, no, when you look at society, the way we train our children, the way we've been trained, both at home and at society, we've been inculcated with the idea that we have to be good. Yes? All energy, so much money spent in trying to correct man's behavior. Yeah? How many spankings to try to understand that you're going to behave in a certain way, and we've been trying to be convinced, and somehow innate in our own nature is a natural response to the idea that we want to be good. True? Yeah. And there is rewards if you behave in a certain way. Thumbs up. If you misbehave, thumbs down. And we're inculcated that what we really need is to be good, when the Bible, God is screaming for 4,000 years, screaming down heaven, trying to convince us of how incapable we are of any goodness and how natural for us it is to be evil. The greatest deception that has been given to man is the deception that you and I must be good for God to accept us. I want you to write that down. Because you're going to hear it now, and when we go out to have water, it's going to be gone of your mind. God is not expecting us to be good for Him to accept us. And according to Paul, the basis, the foundation of our acceptance before God is not based on keeping His law. You could spend the rest of your life obeying that law, trying to be good, flogging yourself to obedience. You can spend your days measuring yourself and trying to grow in obedience and become very good person, and at the end of your lives you come to the Lord and you show Him your obedience, and the Lord says, sorry my son, I cannot accept you. A life wasted. You can spend your life praying, you can spend your life studying the Bible, you can spend your life doing good, you can spend your life feeding the poor, you can spend your life doing good, and at the end of it you're lost. That sounds unfair, doesn't it? So then the question is begged, how are we accepted before God? And Paul, the first thing he says, it is not by works. Come to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2. It's a well-known verse, verse 8 and 9. Paul says in verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. Can it get any clearer than that? You see, whenever Paul speaks about something, you find somewhere in his writings the definition of what he's speaking about. And he has told us that we are not justified by obeying the law, but now he makes it clearer. He says, we are not saved, we are not accepted by God, we are not reconciled by God. God does not look on us favorably because of our conduct, because of our behavior, because of what we can offer him. So what happens then? When I consciously or unconsciously try to find my way to God's heart by the things I do. You know, this is very, very subtle. If I ask any of us, are we saved by works? The natural response is going to be, no. We are saved by grace through faith. That's it, comes like that. But the reality is that all of us, we have a nature that tends to legalism. We all want to be recognized. We laugh when we do something and everyone goes, wow, well done. We feel important. We want to feel that we are valued. And the way society has taught us to be valued is by our accomplishments, by our conduct, by the things we wear, the way we think. And so it is natural for us when we come to and meet God, we think, wow, this is super God. I must come up with something super for him to accept me. It is not something verbal, it is something that goes here. When we were born, they put an SD card right here that says, if you behave good, God loves you. And we spend our lifetime doing two things. First, running away from God because we think that we'll never be able to please him. And then, the rest of our life, if we come to church and we do not find the real gospel, we spend our days trying to please him so that he will accept us. It's unconscious. And so, Paul tells us, guys, it's not by works. It's not by works. But what happens in this experience of me trying to feel assured of his acceptance because, well, I run evangelistic programs, or I give a large offering, or I have won so many souls, or I am looking after the poor, or I am doing this and I am doing that. What happens when my confidence shifts away from Jesus to what I am doing? What is the danger in that? Is there any danger? Come to the book of Romans. We are going to look at four latent dangers in this experience. We come to chapter 4 and verse 1. What then shall we say that Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, what does it say next? He has something to boast about. What does righteousness by works do in our lives? It creates a boasting. It creates pride. It makes me self-exalted. And you find people at church like that. They think they are better than others because of what they do. That is the Pharisaical way of measuring themselves. Their righteousness is of their own, and so they must constantly be measuring themselves against the behavior of someone else. And when they find someone else that is lower than them, they say, and so they say, they're constantly looking at the plate. If you are vegan or you're vegetarian, you get offended if someone is eating cheese. Or if someone is eating meat. then... Yes or no?
Yes.
I am holy. Well, because I wear longer dresses or I do not wear jewelry. We've got a thousand ways of measuring ourselves. True?
True.
And so this is a subconscious thing, and in Adventism it's even more dangerous because Adventism teaches a high life standard, true? And let me say the problem is not with standards, the problem is our heart. Rather than making Jesus our Savior, we make the standards our Savior. Because subconsciously we think that it is, if I can live perfectly these standards, if I am a good Adventist, then the God of heaven will accept me. I have my passage made to heaven. You know, it's becoming ever harder. We used to be vegetarians, now vegans, and now it's coming to be that it's going to be vegetarians. And so the way to heaven is becoming ever more difficult. Fruitarians. Soon the only thing you're going to be left is vegetarians. And I'm not saying I am a vegetarian, most of the time vegan, but I do not put my confidence in that. So the first thing that it does, it creates a boasting. Because I am doing this, I feel that I am a better person. That was the problem of the Pharisee. I thank you that I am not like that tax collector. He looked down on the tax collector. Now, how did God see the tax collector? Let me ask you a question. Who was the worst sinner in God's eyes? Who was in more trouble in God's eyes? The religious man or the tax collector? The religious man was in a greater trouble. Because of his conduct, because of his achievements, because of what he was doing, this man had put the confidence on himself rather than God. He just went to God and paraded himself. Look how good I am, God. Look at it, I've done all these good things. And he expected God to go, wonderful, my son. He forgot. Or maybe he never knew that we are not accepted before God by what we offer Him. Number two, chapter 4 and verse 4. So, the first thing that it does when we begin a trajectory of works, which is natural for all of us, is that it develops in us a pride. Self-centeredness, self-exaltation, we become boastful. Second, verse 4 of chapter 4, now to him who works, his wages, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. Now, this is scary, because it says there that if I am trusting in my works, if I'm working for my acceptance, if I'm working for my salvation, my debt with God is not decreasing, but is increasing. And all the good works that I am trusting upon, they are increasing my debt. They are accounted a sin in heaven. That's why Jesus says to those who are waiting for sin, Lord, Lord, he says to me, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. And these people, all their lives spent preaching and doing miracles and all that, they have put their trust in these things. And therefore, these things, though good, became a debt to them. Because they replaced Jesus. And so let me ask you a question. Who had the worst debt in the eyes of God? The Pharisee or the tax collector?
Pharisee.
It's dangerous to come to church. If you come to church for the wrong reasons, it's dangerous. Dear friends, the only reason why we should come to church is to trust in the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
why we should study the Bible is to trust Him more. The only reason that we should pray is to know Him more. Christ alone is the source of our righteousness, is the source of our holiness. He is everything to us. You remove Him from the picture and you put anything else in his place, and that will condemn you. Doesn't matter how good it is. What else does it do? Chapter 4, and we come to verse 15. Because the law brings about wrath, for where the law, there is no transgression. What does the law do? What does the law do? The law brings wrath. What does it mean by that? Well, this goes together with Romans chapter 7, where Paul says that he wants to do what is good, but he can never do it. And at the end of chapter 7, he says, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death?" You see, friends, there is a latent danger on the law of God for the sinner. Because sin has taken hold of your heart, and sin naturally deceives you. At first, when you know no Jesus, when you know no law, you walk in life as if there is nothing wrong. You can do whatever you want, and there is nothing. You just live it. And suddenly you come to an evangelistic program, and the preacher presents the Ten Commandments, and you go home like this. I'm condemned. And so sin, who controls your mind and your soul, says, "Oh, this boy is going to turn to Jesus. We're going to do something." And so while you're sleeping, while you're there with all the conviction on your heart, and I'm seeing I have done wrong, what shall I do? What shall I do? The suggestion comes, "Wow, all I have to do is just obey that law." And so then you say, "I'm going to start keeping the Sabbath." And you start coming every Sabbath to church. "I'm going to stop. I'm not going to live with my girlfriend anymore. I'm going to marry her. I'm not going to steal anymore. I'm going to pay my taxes. I'm not going to swear anymore." And all those things are good. But if there is no Jesus, they're worthless. And so what happens is that for a while sin lies inside your soul, but hidden, because the only one who can deal with sin is Christ. All that the law does, it magnifies it, it shows it, it points it, so that you go, "Whoa, I've never known," and you become convicted of sin, and you look for a savior, but sadly so many do not turn to a savior, they turn to themselves. And you know what? They become Christians. They're baptized because we look at their conduct has changed, they are acting good. And then comes wrath. Because the law will not leave your mind. The law will continue to point the finger. And then you start, "Why is it that I have no peace?" And you try to act better. Maybe it's because I'm eating this. Maybe it's because I'm not praying enough. Maybe it's because I'm speaking too rough to my wife. And you continue to change your behavior. You try. But the more you try, the more miserable you become. The more empty you feel. And suddenly you start feeling wretched, miserable, angry. There is never freedom. There is never victory over sin. You know that the old sins, you still have them. They control you. The addiction to pornography, the addiction to other things begin to come back. And you begin to sink, and some many leave and others remain because they remain. And so many learn to smile this way. They are the happy Christians. And whenever they come to church, all they do is, "Why does he have the dress so short? And why did he sing so loud? And that pastor can never preach a good sermon.
And all they do is criticize, point to the mistakes and errors. And they sit at home and they eat human beings. They start talking about others. Yes or not? Why? Because the law is creating wrath in their hearts. The law is condemning them. And they haven't found freedom. That is the pathway of the self-righteous. There is no joy, peace, or love in the experience of him who trusts in himself. It even gets darker. Come to chapter 9 of the book of Romans. Chapter 9. We'll take it from verse 30. What shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness. Even the righteousness of faith. Here is the same contrast that Paul presents in the image of the Gentiles and the Jews. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. So the ones who appear to be good and they're always looking for righteousness, they miss it. And the ones, in a sense, who didn't even care about righteousness, have attained it. Why? Paul gives us the answer. He says, because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. For they stumbled at the stumbling block. As it is written, or the stumbling stone, as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Amen. Who is the stumbling stone?
Jesus.
For the self-righteous, Jesus becomes a stumbling stone. That's why Israel crucified the Savior. Why? Because they felt good. They had their own righteousness. They were good enough. They were children of Abraham. They obeyed the law of Moses. They didn't need a Savior. So what did they do with the Savior? They crucified him. Because Jesus became truly a stumbling stone. It was something you trip over. What do you do with the things you trip over? You remove them. And so, dear friends, for the self-righteous, Jesus is not their life. Jesus is not the essence of their experience. For the self-righteous, they are contented with their diet, with their clothing, with their prayers, with their Bible study, with their attendance to church. They are contented with what they are accomplishing. Therefore, Jesus is not their all. Jesus. Well, Jesus. Jesus is something. I get offended if you talk too much about the love of Jesus. Have you heard people that say, oh, I don't go to the church because all they do is they talk about the love of Jesus. Could it be, dear friends, that we are actually offended at Jesus? What do we talk about on Sabbath afternoons, or for you Sabbath mornings? Luncheon or tea? What do we love to talk about? Do we love to converse about footy? Soccer? That's for me, South American. Work? Cars? Money? Girlfriends? Boyfriends? Gym? Studies? Work? But what about Jesus? Why is it that we do not love to talk about Jesus? Why is it that Jesus is not the center of the experience when we come to church? Why is it that Jesus is relegated to Sabbath in our homes? Why, dear friends? It is because we are not in love of Jesus. And why is it that we are not in love of Jesus? Because we have no need of him. And why is it that we do not have need of him? It's because I have my own religion. I have my accomplishment. I can trust in what I can do. It's such a subtle thing, friends. But it is revealed when you ask the question, how much do I love Jesus? Look at the apostles and look at Mary Magdalene. What was Jesus for Mary? For her, he was everything. And she was willing to give everything for him. For the apostles, he got offended. They got offended. Someone showed such love. It's dangerous. Could it be, the friends, that we call ourselves Christians and we are offended at Jesus? Could it be, the friends, that you and I may have a form of religion that is actually disgusting to God, because what we bring to Him is rags that are dirty, and we say, Lord, you can accept me because of this. Do you know why God cannot accept us? By our works. Is there written in the book of Romans, chapter 7, verse 18, it says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, how much good dwells?
Nothing.
How much?
Nothing.
How much?
Nothing.
Nothing good dwells. How much good do I have? Zilch. Zero. None. Dear friends, I am completely empty, bankrupt of anything that would recommend me to God. And therefore, whatever good I think that I can offer God is nothing but filthy rags. My best righteousness. If I could ever come up with the best I can offer God, if I could train myself for a whole lifetime to produce the best I can give Him, and then at the end of my life that I bring it to Him, it's nothing but rubbish, friends. Because in me, there is no righteousness whatsoever. I am bankrupt, empty of anything that can recommend me to God. Therefore, I cannot be accepted by God through the things that I do. Is that clear?
Amen.
Or is it offensive? Maybe this is the last time Byron I'm be preaching. It's been really nice to meet you people like that. Come with me to the book of Galatians. Scary. Galatians chapter 5. The apostle says, verse 3, I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised. He uses circumcision as a symbol, as a way of identifying, trusting in the flesh. Salvation by works. That he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by law, you have fallen from grace. Isn't that scary? No wonder Jesus looks at those people and says, I have never knew you. I have never knew you. Why? Because in their endeavor to offer God their works, they had become estranged from the only one who could save them, Jesus Christ. Dear friends, salvation is not about what I can offer God. Salvation is about what God offers me.
Amen.
Salvation is not about what I promise God. Salvation is about me taking hold of the promises of God.
Amen.
For there is salvation found in none other but in Him whose name is Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. We must turn away from ourselves to Christ. We must cease to trust in man. Cursed is the man who trusts in man. And he says, that's not a statement of me trusting in someone else. That's a statement referring to me putting my trust in myself. There are two religions that walk side by side on the line of right and wrong, and both
look very similar, but they are as far as the north is from the south. And it's the religion that walks on the righteousness of Christ, on His goodness and His accomplishments, and the religion that walks based on my righteousness and my accomplishments. Who do I trust? Who do I love? Who is my life? In the book of Philippians, and we'll finish with this chapter. Chapter 3, Paul speaks about his own experience. Philippians chapter 3, Paul writes in verses 1 onwards, he says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord." Rejoice in who? In the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same thing is not tedious, but for you is safe. Do you know why it's safe? We need to be told this every Sabbath, every prayer meeting. Every time we get together, we need to be reminded of this truth, because self does not want to hear it. I guarantee you that at the moment your stomach is in a knot, and you're saying, "Oh, it's hard to accept it," because self will naturally want to reject this truth, and self wants to forget it. So as soon as you walk out of here, self trying to take it out of your mind. And Paul says, "For me, it is not tedious to write the same thing, but for you it is safe." We must be reminded constantly, constantly we must be convicted of our need of Jesus. Christ is our Savior. Christ is the one who died. Christ is the one who's paid the price. Christ is the only one who can save you. You must turn away from yourself and rejoice in the Lord. And then it says, notice, verse 2, "Beware of dogs." Who are the dogs? The people that were teaching the early church to circumcise themselves, thus making void the grace of God. "Beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. For we are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus," he says, "and have no confidence in the flesh." In modern language, have no confidence in what you can do. Do not put your confidence in yourself, he's saying. And then he says these amazing statements. "Though I also might have confidence in the flesh." If there was anyone who could have confidence in the flesh, he says, that was me. "If anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so." And now he tells us why he could put confidence in his own works. He says, "Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, concerning the law of Pharisee, concerning zeal persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless." Here you have a guy that says, "I kept that law so that no one could point anything evil that I did. I was blameless regarding that law." So he says, if there was anyone who could trust in his words, that was me, until I met Jesus. Verse 7. "But what things were gain to me, this I have counted loss for Christ." What does he mean by that? When on the road to Damascus, Paul came face to face with Jesus. And then as he grew to understand him and love him, when he came to understand the righteousness of God, when he came to see Christ as his Savior, he looked at everything that in his past gave him confidence and assurance to be a son of God, and he looked at that and he says, "That is actually against me. That is my loss," in order to have Christ. And so, dear friends, the question we must ask is, who will you trust? Who shall be your Savior? I hope, dear friend, that you turn to Jesus.
Amen.
For He will save you.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious Father,
Oh Lord, we are all stunned with this deadly disease of trusting in ourselves, of thinking that we can earn your favor. Dear Lord, forgive us. We confess our sinfulness before you, Lord, and we will declare what the scripture says. We are poor, empty, bankrupt of anything good to offer you. But we do not despair, for we have a Savior in whom you have given us everything we will ever need to be accepted by you. May we all, Father, turn to Christ and take hold of him. And if there's anyone struggling here, I pray, Lord, that you will lay hold of that person, and that through your Spirit you will draw them to yourself, that they may see the beauty of Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.